Welcome to the Play Podcast with me, Douglas Schatz.
Hello, and welcome to episode 16 of the Play Podcast, where we explore the greatest new and classic plays. I'm Douglas Schatz, founder and host of the Play Podcast. The curtain rises on our play today on a university professor's office. The professor, John, is talking on the phone. Sitting across the desk from him is a student, Carol. John is apparently talking to his wife about some difficulties in a real estate transaction that they are in the middle of. Under some pressure, John promises his wife that he will be home in 10 to 15 minutes. He signs off, twice telling his wife that he loves her. Carol has waited quietly all this time. We assume that she has come to the professor's office to petition him with some request, an extension for an essay, or some other help she needs for a course she is taking with him. Whatever it is, we now know that he will be pressed for time and likely to be less patient with Carol's entreaty. We also assume that the usual hierarchical relationship between professor and student applies. What unfolds between them over the next 90 minutes will surprise and shock us, profoundly challenging our views of gender and power relationships. This is American playwright David Mamet's provocative play, Oleanna, which when it premiered nearly 30 years ago, caused intense controversy and divided audiences with its portrayal of patriarchal power and how to respond to it. David Mamet is, of course, the author of a number of acclaimed plays that he wrote in the 1970s and 80s, including American Buffalo, Sexual Perversity in Chicago, Speed the Plow, and Glengarry Glen Ross, the latter also having been made into a film that he wrote and directed himself. Oleanna opened in the U.S. in 1992 in Cambridge, Massachusetts, before an off-Broadway run that year, followed by its U.K. premiere at the Royal Court in 1993, in a production directed by none other than Harold Pinter and starring David Suchet and Leah Williams. Mamet's work certainly owes something to Pinter, with its spare, weaponized language and macho menace. Pinter said of Oleanna that there can be no tougher or unflinching play, although interestingly enough, the two playwrights disagreed about the ending of the play, but more about that later. What is not in doubt is that when it was first produced, it generated passionate responses and heated debate about its provocative portrayal of the relationship between the male professor and the female student. The play is now being revived at the Theatre Royal Bath in a new production directed by Lucy Bailey, which was delayed this month because of the latest lockdown, but happily, I'm pleased to say, has been rescheduled to run from the 3rd of December through until the 16th of January with a break at Christmas, all being well. I'm very excited to see the show, not least because it will be a joy to actually return to a theatre again, but also to revisit the play to see how the balance of the debate it provokes may have changed in the nearly 40 years since it first appeared. How differently might we now view the events Mamet presents in the light of the Me Too movement and the continuing sensitivities around our behavior in personal and professional relationships? Well, to address these questions and to talk us through the play with a fresh eye, I'm joined via video link by the director herself, Lucy Bailey. Welcome, Lucy.
Hello.
I know that you're in the midst of final rehearsals for the opening very shortly, so I'm very grateful for you taking the time out to talk with me today. Thanks very much. Before we dive in, I must do a proper introduction to you, however. Lucy Bailey's wide-ranging work as a director has comprised many acclaimed productions, including a number of Shakespeare plays at the RSC and the Globe Theatre, where her renditions of Titus Andronicus and Macbeth were somewhat notorious for their graphic imagery. I can attest to the power of both of these. We took my youngest son to the Macbeth, in fact, when I think he was about 10 or 11, and I recall that the vision of hell from which the witches and bloodied corpses emerge was a bit too much for him. I loved it. On a different note, more recently, Lucy enjoyed both critical acclaim and huge popular success with her production of Agatha Christie's Witness for the Prosecution, which in a masterstroke she staged in the Grand Chamber of County Hall in London, a fitting setting for the classic courtroom drama. And now, as if to emphasize her characteristic nerve and versatility, she takes on the potentially contentious politics of Oleanna. So as I said in the introduction, Lucy, the play was controversial when it first performed and prompted some pretty strong reactions by the audiences because of the intensity of the events that it portrays. So I'm really interested to know what drew you to come back to direct the play at this time.
Well, I was very moved by it. I was sort of shocked and moved. I've never read a David Mamet play, can you believe?
No, you're kidding.
I'm not. It's to my shame. I've seen his plays and I've seen his films, but this was the first experience of reading it off a page. And of course, it's stunning writing. It's so visceral. It's so alive. People say it's very staccato. It does affect you, literally, physically, I find. And it's so tautly written, and the drama moves at such pace, despite it seeming to be so full of words. And in a sense, only two massive actions within the play happen in this hour and a half. But at the same time, things are shifting so quickly.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's the immediacy of the play combined with, of course, the shock of it. I had no notion of what the play was about before I read it. And I do hope an audience comes to see this again without having, perhaps not having listened to this podcast for sure, because you want them to be fresh to the power of this battle that goes on in front of your eyes. And I think that was the other reason I wanted to do it. It is like putting two people into a boxing ring and watching them slug it out with each other. And it's as terrible and voyeuristic and as exciting as that.
Yes. Well, I'm feeling a bit guilty now that you've said this, because we're not going to be able to go through this conversation without spoilers. So that's the reality. We're going to go at it head on, unfortunately. And you'll just have to listen to this after you see the show, because I agree with you. It is shocking. And as the events unfold, it becomes ever more explosive. And that is obviously part of the point of the way he structures the play and what transpires. I think before we dive into the full-on discussion of the issues, because it's also a play that raises really topical issues in a shocking way that you cannot but end up coming out of the theater thinking about it closely and engaging in heated debate. So for listeners who haven't yet seen it or read it and may never do, so they may still be interested in listening to this podcast, as a reminder to those who have, we really need to give a brief summary of what's happening here, at least at the start of the play. I did introduce that we were open in a professor's office, but if you could just introduce the characters that we find there and a little bit about what is unfolding in the first part of the play, Lucy, that will get us started.
Yes, I think that the important thing to know is that John is a professor. We don't know what kind of university. It could be Ivy League. It could just be a state university. It's never stated by Mamet. He teaches, we think, he's a professor of education. He's at that point in his career, which is probably 6 or 7 years down in his teaching at that university, where he can be tenured. And in America, that means you're given a job for life and you're given a big pay rise. And because of that big pay rise and because of this imminent tenureship that he's about to be awarded, which he's 99% sure is going to happen, he's decided to move his family into a much bigger house. He couldn't get that house without the bank, without the tenureship securing that he has the money for that house. So the play opens, as you said before, with him on the phone, apparently with a huge issue that's just happened just as he's about to close on the sale of this house. There's a big issue with the contract. At the same time, Carol, who's in her first year and is studying education with him, so she's a first year student in the second semester. So that means that they're about April, May. This is when also the tenureship is about to be awarded at this time of year. She is frightened that she has failed her paper, that her paper is going to not get the grade that she needs. She wants to graduate to the next stage of doing, I don't know what it's called in America when you become an MA, because if she can become that graduate, she can then secure a job that will pay back this massive debt that, of course, she will be incurring by being at university. So the story is about the student who comes from a poor background, who's frightened of being failed. She's desperate to find out what her grade is, and she wants to see if she can somehow avoid getting failed by this professor. And on the other side, the professor needs to get home to save the situation with the house, and is being delayed by the student against his will at first. And then as the act progresses, he decides to actually stay with the student rather than sort of face his wife back at the house that seems to be falling through. And in staying with the student after hours, this becomes the whole crisis.
Yeah, so he also, I think, at one stage, or very early on, realizes that her work isn't up to standard, and even suggests maybe she should just drop the course, at which point we do discover, as you say, that Carol is desperate not to do this, not to fail. She says many times that she just doesn't understand the work. She's struggling with it, doesn't understand what she's supposed to do. She's worked very hard, takes notes diligently in class, has read his book, the professor's book. And then at some point she breaks down in tears. And his reaction initially is to console her in some way. And of course, this is where it becomes dangerous, because the line between the personal and the professional is one where it's very delicately poised. And I think he crosses this out of one would think a motive that seems to be sympathetic and is just trying to help her to resolve her difficulty, sees her anguish. So he offers that she will be allowed to have an A grade in this course if she just continues to come back and visit him in his office for personal tuition. And when she raises a question about, well, is this legal? Is this okay by the rules? He says, well, it's just between us. It's whatever the rule I make. And he also goes on to say that one of the reasons he's doing this is because he likes her. Now, I guess we may be more sensitive to these things as to where these lines are drawn, as you said, in an after-hours meeting between a professor and a student, than 30 years ago when this play first premiered. So when this sorts of things start to unfold, the alarm bell's starting to go off. So what do you make of what he's doing at that point? Why does he make this offer? How would you portray what his motive is when he says he'd just like to help her?
It's so interesting actually listening to you quote us his lines, because already I'm starting to go, oh my goodness, the way they are quoted, the context is already wrong and suggesting a different motivation for the professor than is in the play. So it's so interesting to hear that as soon as we relay something that's happened in a room that we've not witnessed, already there's two different interpretations of what that action intended. So this is the whole thing. But In working with the actors, my intent has been to show that the professor, however much he might be misusing his power, however much he might have exercised errors in his judgment, did not ever do it from the point of view of doing that. So he only did what he thought he was doing from the best intentions. Of course, you can then re-look at what he did and show that it was an error, but it's the interpretation of the intention behind that error. So it's an error to put your arm around a student. But was his intention sexual, or was an intention purely to comfort? And of course, the professor thinks one thing, the student thinks another, and the whole drama is about the fact there are two different points of view of the same event. And that's what makes it so exciting.
Yes, exactly. And as you described, so he makes this offer about her grade and to coming back to visit him personally and to work on the course. And as you quite rightly say, reading the text, on the surface, you would think this all seems relatively reasonable. His motive seems genuine. He talks about how he would like to break down the stricture between teacher and student. He wants to make it a more personal relationship. All that sounds dangerous when I say that out of context, but when you hear him talk about it, it's actually just his instinctive personal sympathy that is leading him to make this offer and to try and help her.
I was going to say, you could say it's sympathy, but you could also see that it's also power.
Yes.
And you could also see it as a response to Carol's request. So Carol asks him very clearly, she says, asks him for help. And she asks him, when he says, what can I do? She says, you can teach me. You can teach me. Now, you can say, therefore, in John's defence, that he offers to teach her. And the only way he can offer to teach her is to teach her outside class, because all that has already been taught. So he's offering to her to reteach her the whole of that term in an effort to give her that A. Now, he is playing God, because it is not in his gift, actually, to be offering private lessons to a student and hiding her paper that had an F on it and then giving it a guaranteed A. You know, that's completely wrong. But as we see, he does this under pressure of her vulnerability, of her sense of inferiority, of her need for help. So you can argue the case vehemently both ways.
Yes, as people do, as I'm sure we will in a minute. Because you referred actually to even just the offer to help her this way. There is a crucial incident, of course, towards the end of the first act where she is really breaking down in tears and despair. And he puts his arm around her to console her, at which point she cries out loudly, no, and breaks away. And you can see that this has been inappropriate as far as she's concerned. And I think, again, with the benefit of everything that's gone on in our world over the last few years, at least, we think, okay, there's alarm bells going again here in terms of the line, whatever his intent. She then says something at that point about, she was about to confess something about herself that would have opened up potentially an opportunity for him to understand as well her perspective. But again, they get interrupted by a phone call. Phone calls are a feature of the play, which we talk about. But what do you think Carol was about to say to him? We never hear this, but...
Oh, it feels a bit like betraying a state secret at this point in the production.
How can you know? Do you really know, Lucy?
Well, it's exactly. You can't know. So you explore with your actress what you think. So as I say, it does feel as if you're sort of giving away something you're never to know. And I think the ambiguity is quite important for Mamet.
Yes.
That you don't actually know the concrete reason of why she says I'm bad, why she's feeling so in pain over her lack of worth.
Yes.
Now, we have linked it to abuse in her family, possibly with her father, because the repression, her own sexual repression, her difficulty with anything physical, a touch and a no, could all be linked to difficulties with other forms of male control. So that happens to be our way through, because the confession feels not in a good place. It's not so much about there is an act of trust that is broken at this point, of course, because she's telling him something she's never told anybody. But at the same time, there's a feeling that the sense of lack of worth, that she is blaming herself for something appalling in her life, which is what victims of abuse do. They put the blame on themselves.
That's fascinating. I think that's a really insightful view. And it just reminded me that at one stage, John, the professor, actually says to her, in the course of the conversation, I'm not your father. And she responds,
what? Yeah.
Yes, is in some way upset by this and asks him why he would say that. So there's a sensitivity there. It's really interesting that you've found a little key there that might explain it. We could talk about how Carol's character evolves over the play as well, because in this first act, she seems very self-deprecating and unconfident and unhappy. But she gains in strength as the play goes on. We should say there are three acts to the play. We were just talking about the first one at the moment, where we've described essentially what goes on. And there are two further meetings between the two of them in the same office, and things just develop in the what's gone on between them. I was going to say also, when you were saying earlier about two different people seeing the same events from a different perspective, I think one of Mamet's themes is about communication in all his plays. His language, you talked about his language at the start, and he is renowned for this, for his use of language, for representing the fragmented, sort of rapid fire, even illiterate or unsuccessful nature of vernacular dialogue. And there's much of this goes on in their exchanges, and how people can easily misunderstand each other because they're talking at cross purposes. There's a lot of interruption goes on, and of course, the telephone interrupts them. So there's something about this theme that they fail to communicate. Is that fair?
Yes, I think the thing that struck me when I first read it was the way he would interrupt her was a form of sort of physical abuse. Because he would keep robbing her of speech. I mean, he literally almost sort of jumps in her mouth, if you know what I'm saying. I'm putting it as a violent, because it feels violent when you're doing it. So even though the intention is, he's an enthusiast. He is self-obsessed. There's an ego there. He likes his own voice. He's a teacher. Okay. But at the same time, he's denying her a voice. And a lot of Act One is about increasing her confusion and increasing her inability to use language effectively because of the way he denies her communication.
Yes, well, he's interrupting her, never gives her a minute.
All the time.
And actually, there's also a point of contention between them because he uses language which she doesn't understand as well. And she tries to call him out on it occasionally, where he uses a word like paradigm and she says, what does that mean? And he goes, model. And she says, why don't you just use the word model? And it's because there's a certain power that he has, of course, that he's conscious of as a teacher, of his own vocabulary and his expertise, which, as you said, his ego allows him to express. But it's not in the interest necessarily of a successful communication between them.
I think in that instance, it's quite interesting that that's in the second act where she starts to say, why don't you use this word instead? You know, be simpler, be more direct, communicate with likes of me. In the first act, she's so scared. She only ever asks him for meanings and then she writes them down in her notebook. By the time you get to the third act, she's dictating what he should, almost what he should say. And it's a wonderful, you know, it's an incremental, her confidence with language becomes in the end equally abusive with it.
And the power relationship between them, of course, flips ultimately yes. over the course of the play. So what I was interested as a director, how you deal with the phone interruptions and what they are all about. So, you know, the play opens with this one-sided conversation, which goes on for some time. And of course, the nature of that sort of thing is you're only getting part of that conversation and it's struggling to even understand what it might be about and what's being said on the other side. And so it's as theatrical drama, it's pretty static and not your usual live dialogue. And yet this happens frequently in the play. Things just get interrupted and you sit and wait while he has this one-sided conversation. What do you think the intent of this? What is this? This is not accidental, clearly, that he's put all of this in as the structure of the play.
There's so many things here. I mean, it ratchets up tension, of course, because the two are sort of in like a cell. They're like in a sort of prison. I mean, it's meant to be an office, but it's like a prison or a torture cell by the end of it. And all you know about the outside world comes through this phone and through Carol's references to the group, which I'm sure we'll talk about later. But we've spent a lot of time with the phone calls because we've created the dialogue ourselves so that we have voices down the end of the phone. You can't hear what they're saying, but you absolutely can hear a sense of the voice in the phone itself. So you know that it's a live conversation with people that exist outside this cell, so to speak, with a whole other drama going on. And in this instance, obviously a wife and a lawyer attached to John and very much part of his very middle-class world. So also the brilliance of the phone calls is in the first act, there seems to be a crisis going on that is increasingly out of his control. So the more out of his control that crisis goes, the more he invests in the thing he can control, which is his teaching of Carol, to the point that he finally slams down the phone on his wife and basically says to her, I'm not coming, I'm going to spend as much time as I want with the student.
Yes.
So he chooses between the wife and the student, really. And that is the moment where in a way, the biggest mistake is made. But it comes not through his fault, but because of this pressure that the wife is putting on him, which at the end of the first act, as we know, turns out to be a joke. It turns out to be something she was just trying to convince him to come to meet her at this new house so that she could give this surprise party for his tenureship.
Yes.
It's a brilliant thing that Mamet's done there.
You're right that it obviously is a device. It interrupts the flow of things, and that's important at various moments in the play. But it also gives you a glimpse, of course, of John's life, and it's a very effective characterization of him and his life because he is the quite comfortable middle-class family man and takes a lot of this for granted. And there are obviously issues hear about his privilege versus Carol's lack thereof, because as you said earlier, she comes from a poorer socioeconomic background. And therefore, those aspects are at play when you think about the balance of the relationship that's going on here. In Act Two, then, so we come back, it's the same room, the same prison, as you said, sometime later, and we discover that Carol has actually made a complaint to the tenure committee about John's behavior. And John has invited Carol back to suggest that they could try and work this out between them rather than proceed to a formal hearing of the committee. Obviously, he's concerned about that, although he says that he suspects that it'll just be thrown out and it'll be an embarrassment to her. Whether he really believes that or not, he's certainly in his interest to try and play down the circumstances. He says that he doesn't really understand. It goes back again, Lucy, to this point about them not really understanding the same, having the same perspective on the same events. He doesn't understand how he has offended her. And he says that he wants to understand and to try and make amends, to which her response, again, is a further misunderstanding. She takes that as coercion or potential bribery even, which seems to dig him into a bigger hole. And then we learn more about the complaint she's raised, because it's in he has it in writing, and so he can relay some of the terms that she's put into her complaint. And these are quite critical, obviously, not just of what he was doing when they first met, but that his overall manner as a teacher. He's arrogant, he wastes time, he's sexist, he's elitist. And then she also refers to the specific events of Act One, where he was closeted with her and told her a sexually explicit story and moved to embrace her and then said that he liked her, told him about his personal life, offered to change her grade if she visited his office. In all these terms, it sounds very different than what the way he presented it, or perhaps that we even see in Act One. Although that depends on how you, Lucy, potentially direct Act One. At this point, where do you think we stand in terms of how we judge what has gone on between them here? Is Carol's complaint reasonable, or has it been blown out of proportion?
Yeah, this, of course, is where it gets very tricky. We totally understand that her complaint has been partly written by the group. Now, the group is only there to protect students and now, in a way, raise concerns with this kind of behaviour that has been going on for years and years and years. So the group is there for a very good reason. But at the same time, in writing down her complaint, there is already a kind of manipulation of events. We know as the audience it's a manipulation because we've witnessed it. And although we're starting to go, oh my God, what did we see? So we're trying to kind of rewind our memories back. But at the same time, we know we didn't see anything that was so shocking. Seemed so manipulative as the way the words are placed together in this report. So at the same time as we start to deeply distrust the group, Carol emerges as a much stronger voice and one that engages our understanding and belief in her as talking from a point of view of truth. So these two things are happening concurrently. We're on the side of John and then we flip to the side of Carol as she starts to say from her perspective and from her perspective as someone who's come into this university wanting to and imagining this great source of education that's going to further her life and the irresponsibility of the professor and the whole attitude, therefore, of the university to teaching. And this is, by the way, very a huge concern now, isn't it? It's a really contemporary concern of ours that students go and have to pay these big fees back and what are they getting in return? And are they getting that next, as we says in the play, economic betterment? Is that actually being achieved by this massive fees that we're now paying?
Yes. Well, it's interesting about you talk about the group. I don't think we don't ever know explicitly who the group are. But I was going to ask you how you think the involvement of the group and her reference to this changes the balance of our view or not. Because the implication, I mean, John wants her to speak in her own voice. He distrusts the fact that this seems to have been written even by other advisors, by some collective who have an agenda.
Yes.
As you say, that may be representing some larger agenda. I remember at the time of the original production that there were many who expressed outrage and hostility towards the play, partly because it seemed to be an agenda of contemporary feminism. It was a collective political agenda. The personal relationship was being distorted for those purposes. So how do you think the fact that she involves others influences our view about the legitimacy of her perspective?
It does influence our view, but we have to be really careful because the student's case would always be thrown out in preference to the professor. So the power lies on the side of the professor. He's about to be tenured. So yes, there is a case for saying it should really be kept at a personal level. They should be able to talk this out. But I would forgive anybody for feeling sceptical as to whether that would have achieved anything. And Carol would have continued to have been ignored, her needs. So the fact that it's been taken up by the group, I think in some ways is a very positive thing. It's given her confidence, it's given her attention, it's given her an identity, and it's given her validity. But of course, as we see the play progress into the third act, we see the distortion of that, where something becomes about an agenda. But I would say in Act Two, you're in this seesawing place where she needs to be represented. She hasn't got the articulacy, and she needs the strength of a group, if you like, a community, in order to be able to bring her complaint to the tenure committee with any success. And if she has a valid complaint, then that should be heard properly and not just dismissed out of court.
And of course, as you rightly say, I mean, we've seen all too clearly how traditionally the power is unfairly distributed. And, you know, the Me Too generation could not call out because they realized that they were powerless and the institutional stakes were ranged against them. So I sense that there may have been a change in our sense about how these things need to be rectified institutionally, not just at a personal level. You mentioned that at the end of Act Two, the stakes get raised even further. He fails to convince her to resolve the situation personally between them. And she says, no, we need to take this to the tenure committee, all the way to the committee. She tries to leave and he restrains her from leaving to keep her talking, and he actually physically restrains her, and her reaction is to scream, to let me go, and cries for help. This is pretty dramatic, and we know that this is trouble.
Yep. You know, he's just sealed his fate, or we think. Of course, we're then surprised further, but we think, you idiot, you've gone and done it now.
Yes. His desperation was that he just wanted to keep her talking and try and charm his way, talk his way out of this somehow, and he was losing that opportunity, and he just reaches out instinctively to try and restrain her. Not a good move. So Act Three opens, and it's a little further ahead in time again, and we discover that in the interim, the tenure committee has met and rejected his tenure, and that he's to be disciplined. In fact, he's in danger of being fired. And he has asked her to come to the office to make another final attempt to somehow placate her and save his position. She is even less interested, I guess, at this point in what he feels or thinks or what his predicament is. She's certainly not interested in being coerced. He appears to have resigned himself, actually, at some stage. She seems to have all the power by this point, Lucy, doesn't she? She has some fantastic speeches, which actually excoriate his privilege and the elitism of his position and the way he's abused his power, all of which are very convincing and powerful. And he is beaten down by this point. And at his lowest moment, he says to her that he can learn from his mistakes and asks if there's anything that can be done. And she then offers that if the group were to withdraw its complaint, they could do this if he removed books from the course reading list. She presents a list of titles that they would like removed from the reading list, as well as a statement that they would like him to make, presumably of regret, apology, or more. So the stakes seem to me, in terms of the moral balance of the thing, raised even higher. To John, it becomes an issue of freedom of speech, as you might expect. Is Mamet loading the dice here? Is this self-righteous political correctness gone too far? Is our sympathy for Carol's perspective and position undermined?
Yes, I mean, this is definitely his critique of what happens when you start to represent someone an agenda as opposed to your own personal truth. And he's showing that Carol is as much a puppet of the group as, in a sense, John is defined by his own class and his own, if you like, elitism. I think Mamet's highly critical of Carol, at this point, and we are meant to lose some of us. We definitely start to see her as a kind of, it's like Frankenstein's monster. She's almost been created by John, and he's looking at the very thing he's created, which is like a sort of mirror opposite to where he was at the beginning of the play. It's a sort of horror of what happens when someone abuses power in a similar way to how he was abusing power without realizing it in Act One.
Right. But you put it down largely to the group, and I think she references the group as well. This is such a delicate issue, and it's still playing out as we speak, because I just finished reading a book by the American playwright Ayad Akhtar called Homeland Elegies, which is his personal view of the recent cultural trends in America. And at one point, he tells a story about a university professor friend of his who is teaching a course in 19th century American fiction. And for the first time in her career, a group of her students refused to do an assignment because they objected to Mark Twain being on the syllabus. Mark Twain, in their view, being a racist author of Huckleberry Finn. And this is a real live example in a U.S. university in the last 2 or 3 years. However, in the play, as if these stakes aren't high enough, in the balance of the debate, we get to the final moments of the play. And I don't know whether there's any way around actually just describing what transpires here. So major spoiler alert, but we discovered that the phone rings and John's lawyer is on the line. And we discovered that the conversation that they've been having about the tenure and his position at the university, there's even more at stake than that, because Carol's group have said to his lawyer that they may pursue criminal charges for battery and attempted rape for when he pressed his body against her way back in the first act. So this seems like the stakes have got way out of hand. It gets worse because his wife phones at this very moment when he's discovering this, and he tries to console her. He uses a term of endearment. He calls her baby on the phone, which is a pretty common term of endearment in a couple, I'm sure. But the best way to relay what happens, perhaps, is to read the final few lines. And just forgive me, I'm not an actor, Lucy, but I'm just going to relay what goes on here because I don't want it to twist it in any way. Carol says, "I'm going." "Good." Carol exiting. "And don't call your wife baby." "What?" "Don't call your wife baby. You heard what I said." Carol starts to leave the room. John grabs her and begins to beat her. "You vicious little bitch. You think you can come in here with your political correctness and destroy my life?" He knocks her to the floor. "After how I treated you, you should be... rape you? Are you kidding me?" He picks up a chair, raises it above his head, and advances on her. "I wouldn't touch you with a 10-foot pole, you little cunt." She cowers on the floor below him. He looks down at her. He lowers the chair. He moves to his desk and arranges papers on it. He looks over at her. "Well," she looks at him. "Yes, that's right." She looks away from him and lowers her head to herself. "Yes, that's right." Whoa. First of all, I talked about the endings at the beginning, Lucy. Is that the ending you're using?
Yes, we have to. There's no choice.
Mamet's a stickler, isn't he, for that?
Yes.
So actually what happened was that Mamet's first version of the play, the first production in Cambridge, Massachusetts, had a further ending where the professor does actually to some degree recant. And that is an ending that Harold Pinter used in the first production in Britain. But Mamet cut that and left it just as we've described now for his production in Broadway and the film he made of the play as well, and is insisting that that's the way it should be now. So how do you think these final moments then affect the balance of the debate and the views of the audience about what's gone on, Lucy?
Well, I suppose it's where Mamet is sort of saying that for John, where language fails, physical action, violence takes over. So he's basically saying that however civilized and however much John would be horrified at any accusations of the potential in him to assault or harm or, let's say, even rape or any of those things against another human being, are suddenly in this massive flash shown to be absolutely within his gene pool almost.
Yes.
Simply there, inherent in everything, in the system, in this whole society, is that very violence towards women. And what's wonderful is he gives him this one well, he gives us this moment of stopping, realizing it, and a huge moment of self-recognition that we haven't had in the play up until that moment. So in a way, John has been in denial all the way through the play that he has any responsibility to anything that Carol has said. But at this big moment, I think he realizes that that is what's within.
Yes, that's absolutely right. And we see that that's what's within. But this is what fascinates me as well, because apparently during its first run, the beating was often accompanied by applause, cheers, and exclamations of encouragement to the professor. And one of the actresses who played Carol in the off-Broadway production used to get abused when she left the theater. People were so heated up about how she had actually brought the professor down and were sympathetic to the professor, even with this demonstration of brutal, innate violence. It's extraordinary that that was the reaction. At its extremes, the play seems to offer a choice between political correctness gone mad, fueled by some dogmatic political agenda, versus the abuse of patriarchal privilege and power. And I was fascinated, actually, when I was doing a bit of research about the film, which I haven't seen recently, but the film is listed on Google Play, Lucy, and there's a blurb about the film, which reads as follows. When an aloof college professor refuses to pass a failing female student, she resorts to leveling bogus charges against him. That's it. That's a summary of the play and film.
Wow.
I don't know when that was written, but a while ago, I suspect.
Before Me Too, I think.
Yes, pretty clear where the blurb writer sits in the debate. But do you think Mamet said himself that he insisted that Oleanna did not take sides? Although, as I've described, at the time it first came out, it was pretty clear cut that people mainly felt that Carol was the villain of the piece. Do you think he loads the dice in one way or another? Or have we changed, has the world changed and we've changed about how we view it? Or it was always there in this play, this kind of ambiguity even?
I think the ambiguity is there because I think you switch sides a lot within the play. And I hope that when you come to do a production, you have to try and address that balance so that you don't load the dice entirely in the favour of the professor, because in a sense it is his tragedy. She emerges as the antagonist and he does have a massive fall, but so does she. So it feels in a rather different currency. Her fall is terrible. She is beaten up. She will carry scars of that for the rest of her life, just as he will never recover from what will now happen, because he will now go to prison. His marriage will be potentially destroyed. His career is over. He has become nothing.
Yes.
But I think she will also, having been the flavour of the group, I think she will also very quickly find that that power is ephemeral and again find herself back with nothing but this terrible thing that's happened in this room. So I don't think either of them come out well. But because it's a tragedy, I do feel that there is a sense where we see a distortion of the truth. We see somebody abuse power to an extreme place in Act 3, take a final sort of cheap shot in terms of telling him not to call his wife baby. That is overstepping the mark at that point. Of course, she then cannot deserve to be beaten. And this is where the play is so brilliant, that we can be so manipulated by the writer that we should get so angry at that moment with her. And in fact, as you say, the people cheered and applauded. And one woman in a Q&A apparently said to David Suchet, who played John, she said, "I found myself almost saying, kill the bitch." And she said she was so appalled that that would have come out of her. And I do think that is the brilliance of what Mamet's written. So you have to make sure in directing the piece that you bring the audience to see the vulnerability of Carol and to see where that journey goes, but to see that they both abuse power.
Yes.
And the play is a discussion of a breakdown of trust. It's a discussion of a betrayal of each other's humanity. And it's also a plea for us to keep human and not to allow our own controversies to be appropriated by other people's agendas. So if anything, it's a plea for not abusing each other. And John abuses Carol definitely, not physically actually, but by every other place without thinking of it, he does it. And because she recognises that, and because she challenges on that, him on that, and because she's taking things that he thought were his right and his natural right, she's sort of threatening them and taking them away. His responses both times are violent. One, in restraining her, two, in beating her up. So Mamet is exposing something about our humanity, I think, which is brilliant, you know, and truthful.
It's fascinating you say that about being human, because there is a point in the play I was going to mention when John, again, trying to appeal to Carol, that they should be able to communicate with each other one-to-one, personally, on a human level, to understand each other. And he outlines a way that people should conduct a conversation or a debate, even when they have fundamental disagreements, without it becoming fixed or personal. I found this quotation, actually, which he outlines this approach. "I can tell you what I think, and then you decide. And you don't have to fight with me. I'm not the subject. And where I'm wrong, perhaps it's not your job to fix me. I don't want to fix you. I would like to tell you what I think, because that is my job, conventional as it is, and flawed as I may be. And then, if you can show me some better form, then we can proceed from there." But just like when he says exchanging trivia about the weather, it isn't just about the weather. It's not just nice day, isn't it? I don't think we can proceed until we accept that each of us is human. Now, this seems to be a pretty reasonable way to approach things. It doesn't work. It's self-serving at the time in terms of the tactics he's trying to use to get her to retract. But the point seems reasonable, doesn't it?
I think it does work. I think that what's so marvellous, again, is that Mamet shows this moment where she falters. She looks, I mean, it works. One's also aware he is being self-serving, so he is being manipulative at this point, even though he's getting closer to a sense of simple conversation between each other. The power is still firmly, in a sense, weighted towards him. But she wavers about the nature of the group and her relationship to it. And at that point, he says, "If you and I, you and I," and of course the phone rings. And by the end of the phone call, she's literally retrenched, and she's become absolutely, she just talks from the group's position again and closes the door on that. And that's when she starts to leave, and he resorts to the first time, a sense of physical violence in terms of restraining her. His desperation suddenly breaks through. But there was this little crack moment, I think, which Mamet places there, that the whole play could change at that point.
You're absolutely right. It's so close. It looks like he's reaching her, and that they might actually come together in some form there, that she might speak to him on those equal terms, or they might have that kind of conversation potentially, and they get interrupted, and then she backs off. Because she's reminded of all the other things that he has in his life, it just distances her immediately. But it's interesting, I thought, that this sounded so topical for our times, doesn't it, Lucy? I mean, this kind of failure to communicate graciously or even courteously about things we disagree about. We can see in our public debate how adversarial it is and how personal it becomes, and how easily freedoms of speech can be curtailed, or there's aggressive or even dangerous behavior towards each other who we don't agree with. This all sounds hugely topical, doesn't it?
Yeah, I think so. I think Mamet's really onto it, this whole combative language that we use, positioning powerful at the expense of sometimes very clear human values.
Yes. And also, I think what you touched on earlier about the differences in perception, I think that in terms of interpreting what's going on, seems to me one of the crucial themes here in terms of how to understand how to behave in these circumstances, because these are circumstances that are being repeated all over the world, as we know, right?
Yes.
In every walk of life, in every professional relationship, where there's power imbalances and gender as a factor, as well, as we obviously know. So how do we tread those lines properly? And I think one of the clues is about perception. John says early on, we can only interpret the behavior of others through the screen we create. In other words, coming from our own prejudices and perspectives. And he's aware of this, but actually in theory, but not really, that, you know, his own prejudices are coming to bear almost all the time in the way he's behaving. And what Carol demonstrates in her responses at various stages is that it's his interpretation of how he's behaved is not the most important. It's how she perceives how he's behaved, and her perception is as legitimate as his. And he has never understood that. And she cries out at one stage that it's not for him to say whether, you know, for example, the touching her was devoid of sexual content. She says it was not devoid. I say it was not. Don't you understand? It's not for you to say what I felt about this experience. That seems to me one of the fundamental things that's come out of Me Too as well, isn't it?
Yes.
That's kind of understanding of the other's perspective and whether how they feel about it. For example, whether you have permission to speak personally or to touch someone or not. We have now much more aware of that as a perspective than we would have been when the play first came out, would we not?
Yes, and this has been very interesting in rehearsal, actually, just finding that that we are now post the 90s and post Me Too means that our understanding of physical language is always more, we always question those boundaries in a very, very clear way. And we have to remember in the 90s that wasn't the case. It wasn't educated to that extent. So John came from a culture where male invasion, if you like, of the boundaries happened all the time. A culture where also the professors or older males would assume and could get female acquiescence. For instance, at the time, one out of 50 female students was offered a higher grade for sex.
Wow.
So the culture was profound, endemic. That was what happened. And I think we're now so far, much hopefully, and continuing to be more sophisticated and educated about that. I had a hard time kind of getting the actor to even touch, innocently touch. And now that's an interesting word that I use. From the perspective of the professor, to touch innocently, because he makes these assumptions that one can. And in the 90s, for the first time, really out of the 80s, 90s, the woman was starting to say, no, 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 this is not acceptable. And now we fully understand that. It still can be abused, but the voice of the victim is trying to be heard. I still think in universities, you know, we did this fantastic thing where our actress, Rosie Sheehy, consulted a student at Cambridge today who happened to be American, who is representative of the students for this kind of abuse. And so we role played, and so Rosie just rang her up as Carol and put her case to her. And it was such a fantastic thing that this student listened, understood. Everything she said gave Carol a voice. It sort of lifted a burden off Carol because she was believed and listened to. It's hard to say just how extraordinary this tiny moment of improvisation and role-playing made us understand what Carol would have experienced by going to this group, seeking help, being heard, being listened to, and then given all the structures where they said, right, we'll write the complaint with you, we will come and sit in the meeting with you. So at all points, she would have been helped by this student because it's so weighted, the other side.
Yes.
It's so weighted towards the professors. It's so difficult. And if your case is thrown out, the student's life is also, it can be extremely painful.
This is fascinating because it strikes me that this is different than it would have been when the play first came out. And I would return to the beginning to ask you, in a way, how do you think things have changed in the world that makes the way we view it differently, and why you think it's important to do this play now still? Because in some respects, does it feel dated, this play, or is it still as relevant, but we just have different terms for how we now approach and discuss it?
I think it's still as relevant. I don't feel it's dated in any sense. I feel we do hear it differently, and I think we hear Carol differently. And I think that would be a really positive thing. I think Carol will be less instantly vilified, and I hope that within each act you hear, as you said before, very powerful arguments coming from her own perspective that we absolutely can endorse and feel are truthful. So I think that I don't think it will raise quite the same, in a way, misogynist fury that it maybe raised when it first was performed.
One can't imagine that it would.
No.
One just can't imagine that it would. The world has changed, and our sensitivity to that perspective and the truth of that perspective surely is much higher than it was.
But I hope we'll still be shocked, though, that two human beings could end up at that terrible place they end up at the end of that play. That's truly shocking.
It is, and I think that kind of antagonism is something we see in our world writ large, as we talked about a few minutes ago. And, you know, you think about the political debates that we have in this country or in America, and the hard lines that people are taking, and even you thinking about gender relationships and gender politics. I mean, you know, so much has improved, of course. And as you say, the institutions, like you were describing at the university, who has this support even available. And we know that companies and institutions around the world have redrafted guidelines on behavior, and all of us are aware of some of these things to a much higher degree. That said, you know, you still have a president of the United States who's clearly misogynist and who legitimizes behavior that should not be possible or encouraged, but as we've just suggested, is their innate possibly anyway, but given permission, that's obviously not what we should be encouraging. So it remains topical, I would say, in all those respects.
Absolutely.
I was going to ask you one last question, which was, do you feel that as a woman, you see the play differently, for example, than its original male directors, Mamet himself and Pinter, might have done?
That's really delicate, that question. I hope I would, in a sense that I hope that there's a sort of in-tuneness to Carol that's there, a huge empathy. I have huge empathy for both characters, and I do feel that the play isn't necessarily wanting you just to be black and white. It's wanting you, as you have discussed all this time, to get to understand the complications of debate and what happens with entrenched positions and agendas. So it's a really, really interesting one. I would be able to answer that on other plays much more simply than I can answer that on this play.
Interesting, because this is one that's graphically about gender relationships and gender power. But what I've loved about the conversation and hearing your view is this is not just a simple debate about what the issue at stake is. It's about how each one of them has ended up behaving in unexpected ways, and in ways which they're not potentially proud of themselves, even potentially, who knows, that may hurt themselves as well.
Yes, betraying.
And I don't think I'd appreciated it in those terms as well as you've expressed it. My last question is, what do you want audiences to leave the theater thinking?
Oh, gosh, that's so good. You know, that's a difficult question when you're so close to the play. We've just finished our last day of rehearsal today. At the moment, one's so sort of bruised by the play, if you see what I mean. One can't almost step back from it. I think I would be very pleased if they did leave with a sense of debate. You know, I loved reading the audience reactions, or couples quarrelling and going off in different taxis, you know, that happened in the 90s. I would love some passionate debate to be happening, really, rather than just angry, entrenched points of views. I would love people to go to the pub if they're open and discuss exactly what we've said, that the failings of human beings at these moments and the abuse in all subtle levels of power and our unconscious abuses of power that we don't realise we're doing. And this really does touch, you know, with Black Lives Matter, with Me Too. This is the discussion where we have an inherent prejudices that we don't identify and we live with quite often without questioning and without educating.
I think you've answered the question beautifully, because it isn't black and white, and that's the point of the play, and that's why I think it still has the power it does to unsettle us. It is ambiguous and messy, and I actually think it's better for being less black and white than it might have been once even. There is no risk that this will not generate debate, Lucy, I'm sure.
Oh, good.
Thank you so much. That's about all we have time for on the play. I wanted to ask you one more thing, though. One of the traditions of our podcast is that I like to ask my guests to recommend a play that we could talk about in a future episode. So is there a play that you'd love to direct one day, maybe, or is a personal favorite that you'd be happy to nominate?
Oh, there's so many. But so I thought I would nominate one that I've read recently in the hope that I might direct it, which is Patrick Marber's Closer. And that's partly that the sort of portrayals again. It's sort of got something similar to Oleanna. It gets under your skin in a terrible way. And it's about the truth and our lies to ourselves that are so profound. you know, the way we live with our own lives and don't recognize the truth of what we're doing, which we all do.
And in our relationships.
Yeah, it's a power struggles within relationships and the abuse of power within our relationships that the play discusses as well. So I was really surprised and by reading this play, as I thought it was going to be quite dated, written in the 90s again. And it comes off the page as, for me, not at all dated, still very current. It's asking, you know, the right questions of ourselves.
Well, we'll definitely put it on my list, and I very much hope that you can do it, and then I can call you back and we can do this again.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, Lucy, for joining me today, for taking the time out of your busy schedule, and the very best of luck with your production. Before we bring the curtain down today, I would just like to make a brief plug, if I may. If you're interested in reading the full text of the plays that we discussed during our podcasts, you can purchase them by visiting our website at theplaypodcast.com, where you will find all of the text displayed on the relevant pages for each episode. By clicking through to order any of them from our website, you'll be helping in a small way to support the podcast, as we will earn a small affiliate commission on each sale. We've partnered with both bookshop.org and Blackwell's to supply the texts, so you'll also be supporting independent bookshops when you order from us. Many thanks. As the curtain falls on the prone figure of Carol on John's office floor, how do we judge what has happened between them? Can we say definitively that one or the other is at fault for the conflict that has exploded between them? Or is the point that it's not that simple to untangle the desires and prejudices that compel us, and that at the very least, we need to be more aware and tolerant of the perspective of others in both our intimate and public interactions? Thanks for listening. Stay well until next time.
Thanks for listening. To listen to other episodes, to find out news about future episodes, or to leave comments about what you've heard, please visit us at www.theplaypodcast.com. You can also follow us on Facebook or on Twitter at ThePlayPod. You're also welcome to email plays@theplaypodcast.com to suggest plays that we could talk about in future episodes. You can also register your suggestion on the website. Thanks again, and see you next time.